Oh yeah, yeah. What you looking at here? This is a bone growth, and I'll draw half of a long bone here. Talk about the different parts of bone, the epiphysis, the diaphysis, and we talked about two different kinds of cartilage. One was right here, before the bone's fused. What's that called?
Cartilage.
Two cartilages. Seal. Right? It's a growth plate. Growth plate cartilage, epiphyseal cartilage. That's the one we're talking about. This is that, just to wake you up this morning. And bone growth describes how bones get longer. So let me hit the record button.
She pushed record.
Oh, thank you. Sweet. No, thank you. You have permission to do that. All right, so bone growth is when bones get longer. So a young child growing up, and the details to know about that are in this figure here. Remember, what you're doing with this cartilage here is you're replacing cartilage with bone. But as long as cartilage persists, you'll continue to grow up and get longer, you'll get taller. Replacing cartilage with bone. Talked about that a lot last time when I talked about ossification. That's all ossification is, replacing cartilage with bone. So what happens is it's like you have bone tissue at the bottom of the slide, right? This bone tissue down here. And the blue line is cartilage. And it's kind of chasing that cartilage. And when it gets to the edge, the bottom edge there, it's like the cartilage is dying at the bottom edge, and it's being replaced by bone. But the top edge are younger cells. So the top edge of my blue line is the top of this figure. And at the top edge, you got cartilage cells that are dividing and dividing and dividing. They're not dead yet. So they continue to kind of like run that way. It's like they're running away. And as they continue to divide and you get more cartilage, I mean, the bone's gonna like get taller, right? I'm just kind of drawing a dot. It's getting, the whole bone is gonna get longer because the shaft is getting longer. But eventually the bone tissue will catch up at puberty because the hormonal changes, and then this will completely ossify and this process stops. So this process is kind of outlined here. We kind of learn about the growth plate by studying the different zones, like the top to the bottom here. That first zone is where all the young cells are. It's the proliferation zone of the cartilage. And the proliferation zone is where the chondrocytes are dividing, right? The cartilage cells. And chondrocytes divide. As long as you got cells that are dividing, you're going to have cartilage, and you're going to continue to grow up until you puberty ends, I guess. And so no problem there. Now, when you get lower down in that cartilage plate, they call that the hypertrophic zone. When cartilage cells get big, they calcify and die. Okay, we kind of talked about that before. Part of the intramembranous ossification talk. Well, anyways, it's the same concept here. Hypertrophic zone. Okay. The older cartilage cells, they enlarge. Chondrocytes enlarge. it's always a prelude to they will die, basically. Okay, so that's the third step, calcification zone. They calcify and die after that. At zone three, you're not seeing those chondrocytes anymore. These are all chondrocytes in lacuna. The reason why they look like potato bugs is they're undergoing mitosis. But here they're getting big and they're starting to die here. And so that's where you get the calcification zone. I think you know what's going on. The matrix is becoming calcified, but that kills the cartilage cells. Chondrocytes die. So there's not going to be any cartilage anymore if those chondrocytes aren't there to maintain the cartilage matrix. So that's when the tissue, you know, you become calcified, then you completely ossify. You get new bone formation in the bottoms of that's bone tissue there, basically. Say new bone tissue. So these zones will persist until you finally catch up with the cells at the top and then you stop growing. So that's longitudinal bone growth. So bone growth and bone remodeling are different things. I don't want you to confuse the two. This is bone growth. Bones get longer when you grow up. Bone remodeling can happen as you're a child growing up, but also in adulthood too. But adults don't grow anymore. You stop growing, right? Bone growth is described, bones get longer. Remodeling is, think of them as packets of remodeling units, where the remodeling includes first the breakdown, then the deposition. Because when you remodel, again, you have to like break it down before you build the new things. And like I gave the analogy of like remodeling your kitchen. You gotta get demo and get rid of the old stuff, then bring the new stuff in. And same concept here. Break it down in one place, build it up in another, probably to strengthen bone. Okay. Overall, the bone will retain a stronger structure. So that process, a couple slides in your book I think are pretty useful. Okay, so they compare bone growth to remodeling using a picture now. I explained it using the growth plate. I didn't explain it using the articular cartilage as an example, but they say cartilage grows here, cartilage is replaced by bone here. See how they use the edge? Okay. Cartilage grows here, cartilage replaced by bone here, and the whole bone's going to get longer. That's what I just described right here. So here what they're saying is you resorb bone here. Remember that word resorb means? You break the bone down. So it was here. You take that bone and you deposit it somewhere else. And you say bone is added somewhere else to make it stronger. Okay, so they're trying to show you how this new bone here got reshaped from this shaped red line before. It was remodeled. So that's the difference there. Break down bone, that's called bone resorption. In one location. Then deposit it in another location. Thank you. So resorption, bone deposition, that's a remodel. There are other terms that are kind of used, like they use the term appositional growth. Let me get these terms on the board. This is more or less, you kind of like build bone around blood vessels and you increase kind of the girth or the width of the bone. And you also have, you can also have bone modeling as opposed to a remodel. A remodel is first you break it down, then deposit. Bone modeling is just do the deposit part, okay, without the breakdown first. Just deposit bone, no resorption. I have a couple of YouTube links that kind of illustrate these ideas a little better. Do you have a question?
Yeah, appositional growth, bone growth around.
I purposely didn't write anything on the board because I thought the YouTube clip would show it better. So let's take a look at that. Hopefully it answers your question.
YouTube. All right, here we go. Let's see.
Bones grow through the process of appositional growth, the formation of new bone on the surface of older bone or cartilage. Osteoblasts beneath the periosteum lay down bone to form ridges around a blood vessel. The blood vessel lies in a groove between the ridges. The groove is transformed into a tunnel when the bone built on the adjacent ridges meets. The periosteum of the groove becomes the endosteum of the tunnel. Osteoblasts from the endosteum lay down bone to form a new concentric lamella. The production of additional concentric lamellae fills in the tunnel and completes the formation of a new osteon.
So that's it. So that's what I want you to know for the appositional growth thing. For bone remodeling and modeling, there's a cooler one I found. I need the pause button here. That'd be worth looking at. Let me run this back. This one's a little more professional and fun to watch, I guess.
The skeleton changes across the human lifespan. This is characterized predominantly by bone formation and growth throughout childhood, followed by a gradual loss of bone density that begins in early adulthood that can accelerate significantly in older adults. The density of bone is modulated by a group of cells including osteoclasts, which are multinucleated cells that resorb bone, and osteoblasts, which refill the resorption cavities created by osteoclasts. Osteoclasts anchor themselves to the surface of bone. This creates a microenvironment underneath the cell, which is referred to as the sealed zone. Within this zone, the osteoclasts create an acidic environment that dissolves the bone's mineral content. Once the mineral content of the bone has been dissolved, enzymes released from osteoclasts remove the remaining collagenous bone matrix to complete the process of resorption. Following resorption, osteoblasts move into the resorption space and start to produce and deposit organic matrix called osteoid. Osteoid, a substance made predominantly of collagen, forms a scaffold in which minerals including calcium and phosphate begin to crystallize. Some active osteoblasts become trapped within the matrix they secrete and thereby become osteocytes. Other osteoblasts will undergo apoptosis or will revert back to lining cells which cover the surface of bone. This cycle of bone resorption and formation is referred to as remodeling. There is also a process where bone formation by osteoblasts occur without prior bone resorption by osteoclasts. This results in an increase in bone mass and is referred to as bone modeling. Bone modeling promotes the growth of bones and is important for maintaining bone strength. Remodeling also plays an important role during bone growth by optimizing the growing structure. After the age of 30, most people experience a gradual loss in bone mass due to a relative decrease in the activity of osteoblasts compared with osteoclasts. However, there are many factors that impact the process of bone remodeling and influence the degree of bone loss we experience as we age. For example, medications such as glucocorticoids, which can promote osteoclast activity and also reduce bone formation. Proper nutrition and physical activity can help strengthen bone. It is also believed that osteocytes form a complex network in bone that can sense any increased workload on the bone and respond by triggering the differentiation and activity of osteoblasts to increase bone density. Conversely, when bone experiences reduced loading conditions, such as during long-term bed rest, resorption and remodeling increase to eliminate underloaded bone. Loss of bone mass reduces its strength and increases the risk of fracture. This highlights the importance of staying active, maintaining good nutrition throughout life, and being aware of personal risk factors associated with low bone density.
All right, well, I thought that kind of illustrated some of the basic ideas. I like how they show the bone cells in animation. That was pretty good. Well, anyways, those are the links to those two that you just watched. You want to check it out yourself. And so the video touched on some things I want to get to. Now, one thing I didn't talk about is the hormonal maintenance of bone levels. I mean, pretty much you tap your skeleton as a source of calcium. If you put the centerpiece on blood calcium levels being maintained, you can use the skeleton in that way. Okay, and so hormones can regulate that blood calcium homeostasis. So I want you to know the hormones that affect bone deposition, bone resorption. The hormones are shown here. Let's do the top one first. If calcium homeostasis is to be maintained, but you have an imbalance, say you know, in your diet, you eat a lot of dairy or eat a lot of food that has calcium in it, and calcium levels rise in the blood, the thyroid gland will secrete a hormone called calcitonin. This gland is located basically in your throat, right below your voice box. Your voice box is a shield-shaped structure called the thyroid cartilage. Thyroid means shield shape. So that gland is right below it, so that's where it got its name from. Anyways, the hormone from that is called calcitonin. So the imbalance is rising levels of calcium. The gland that responds is the thyroid. Okay. It senses that, it mobilizes the correct output, which is calcitonin. Now, hormones use the bloodstream to travel to their effectors, to their targets. So it doesn't really show you that, you just kind of have to know it. It uses blood, it travels throughout the body. What it's going to do, it's going to stimulate calcium to deposit in the bone. So calcium deposition will kind of win out here. Now, which are the cells that deposit
the calcium into the bone. Is it the osteoclasts or osteoblasts? The osteoblasts, they're the ones that make the new bone. Those create the osteoid, then it gets calcified. So their activity will be increased compared to osteoclasts during this process. And so that takes you back to homeostasis. It was high, and this could kind of return you to homeostasis. So the hormone that does the opposite effect, if calcium levels are low, you want to raise it. It's the bottom half of the figure. So it's the opposite imbalance. There's actually, this is a posterior view of the same gland. It turns out there's four little nodules that secrete a hormone that does the opposite. So this big gland, parathyroid thyroid gland, basically regulates calcium levels for the whole body. Well, anyways, they pick up on the decreased level. They secrete a hormone called parathyroid hormone. So parathyroid glands, parathyroid, okay, they release PTH. I'm not going to write it out. It stands for parathyroid hormone. So that hormone, the target, they show pictures of osteoclasts. It's going to increase their activity. More osteoclast activity, osteoblast activity, there's a net bone resorption, okay? So I'll write that, net bone resorption. Therefore, calcium levels will rise because you're liberating more calcium ions from the matrix and then you'll restore homeostasis. So that's kind of how you want to think of it. So hormonally, blood calcium levels are maintained. They use the skeleton to do that. The other thing that the video touched on, like emphasizing the importance of physical activity, is we call it the mechanical load, the weight-bearing exercise. So know the influence of the mechanical load. Inactivity, you're going to see a loss in bone mass, bone mineral density. You always want to basically be physically active, do weight-bearing exercises, keep it high, because bone will hypertrophy and you'll have strong bones. So on one end, physical inactivity will give you loss of, we'll call it BMD, stands for bone mineral density. Physical inactivity, you worry about if you had surgery on your back or something, and you're ordered to stay in bed. You can't do anything. Bed rest. That's a good example. Because you're supine, you're not ever standing up, and that's a problem. You're disabled, bed rest. Another problem is you worry about for astronauts. Maybe they're assigned to a space station or in orbit for a long time, zero G. That's a concern for them, okay? Because they're going to be losing their bone mineral density. So those are two common examples of where it's not enough. And so you want to be physically active, do weight-bearing exercise to keep the mechanical load high. Do weight-bearing exercises to keep mechanical load high. You see in my picture, the response of bone is it will hypertrophy. As opposed to if it's low, the bone atrophies due to the loss of the bone mineral density. So you basically just want to stay physically active throughout your whole life. There's no real homeostasis here. You want to be tilted towards high throughout your life. The younger you are, the more you should be physically active because you have more capacity to exercise. Because with age, the efficiency of the osteoblast declines, so therefore, rate of bone formation would be less than rate of bone resorption. Therefore, you have this net deficit of BMD, right? You lose bone. And a clinical manifestation of that, if it's too much, is osteoporosis. You just have weak brittle bones. And so osteoporosis is really the subject when we get to next. And it's the manifestation of bone atrophy resulting in low trauma fractures. So if you break down the word, you know what osteo is a reference to. Porosis means porosity. Just like the bone shouldn't look as porous as it does. A clinical manifestation of too much loss of BMD, bone mineral density. Now the problem with that is, again, it says low, you increase your risk of low trauma fractures. This is an age-related thing, usually. You worry about the elderly when they have a spill and break their bones. The most common breaks, you know, wrist, spine, hip, all kind of list those. Fracture of wrist, spine. Since we're in anatomy, the back bones are called vertebra, right? In the hip. And in particular, we kind of worry about the femoral neck. That's where it gets snapped. Show you some pictures of this. That's the problem. Okay? The problem isn't necessarily you have brittle bones. The problem is when you break them. Okay? You want to correct the problem if you can to prevent those fractures. I have some more bullet points here. There's a couple of types of osteoporosis. Type 1 is associated with menopause, so this is for females. Type 1. The hormonal change with menopause seem to accelerate trabecular bone loss. Menopause is when in a female, the reproductive life of a female ends throughout a reproductive life when you go through puberty, say 12, start at age 12. And then about age 50.5, that's kind of the average onset of menopause, when the ovaries are depleted of eggs, there's no more. There's hormonal changes that happen. Okay, it's like your brain is trying to stimulate your ovaries to secrete more estrogens and progesterone, but it can't. There's no more eggs to ovulate. And so those hormonal changes can be associated with type 1 osteoporosis, where you kind of see these things. So typically in women 15 to 20 years postmenopausal, we might see this type of osteoporosis. Females, the sign for female, 15 to 20 years postmenopausal. So type 2 is just, we just say age related. Okay, it could be a man or a woman. Typically seen after the age of 70 years. So I'll just put 2, age related. So basically more than 70 years. Okay, we'll just throw that in there. So type 1, type 2, we typically see it in the elderly. Maybe a lifestyle of being physically inactive. I give a little picture there because I say accelerated trabecular bone loss. It's not hard to tell which is the osteoporotic bone. There's just less of those little trabecular struts. So here's some data. U.S. Caucasian women, just to give you an idea of what studies show. So you take 100 ordinary women in 3 age cohorts, 35, 55, 75. You just line them up, and you got the statistics here. The ones in purple would have a fragility fracture within the next 10 years. So obviously, it's age-related. It can have to be a study with women, so you also have the type 1s associated. So just to give students a general idea, this is basically an age-related disease. Your risk increases as you get older. So to give you some numbers here, the slides are a little bit old, but if anything, it's increased. 1.3 million fractures annually, okay, are attributed to osteoporosis. By the age of 80, the majority of women have had a partial wedge fracture. So you get kind of slumped in the shoulders there, get a little shorter, literally, because the spine is crushing. Height loss, kyphosis is that kind of hunchback of the spine. It could cause you pain, okay, if you're pinching nerves there. It could be painful. Now, some more facts, let's see here. You got about 250,000 adults greater than 45 years of age, they have a hip fracture every year. 12 to 20% of fractures are associated with excess mortality. That means about 1 out of 5 fractures, that person will probably end up in a nursing home and end up dying. Maybe not directly as a result of the fracture, but other things. When you have a hip fracture, you're like bedridden, and maybe your other systems get weakened because you're not active anymore. So that's what they mean by excess mortality. Maybe die for other reasons. In fact, they say that only 25% of hip fracture patients gain full independence. Like I said, they probably need some kind of assisted living, whether it's full nursing home or someone comes to your house and helps you out with daily living or your kids. So 3 out of 4 don't do so well. I mean, okay, only 25% gain full independence. 1 in 5 people with hip fractures end up in a nursing home within a year. So it's a big deal, right? If you hear your grandpa breaks their hip, that's a big deal. It's not like a young person breaking their hip. So it's not just the hip fractures that are bad. All these low trauma fractures are associated with premature mortality. It's not just hip fractures, thus all low trauma fractures in the elderly should be regarded as important events. All right. So the causes of osteoporosis. It could include a lack of estrogen, right? Like I said, after estrogen. After menopause, you have a lack of estrogen. When you learn about the ovaries, what you'll see is the ovaries, which ovulate, that's where the eggs are, right? The cells that are fertilized by the sperm.
they have all these follicular cells that support them. They secrete the estrogen from the ovaries, and they're not there anymore after menopause, and so there's no estrogen, because estrogen in a fertile female stimulates the osteoblast. So the other thing is, female athletes who overtrain can disrupt that activity too. It's another thing. There's dietary calcium. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So if you're taking like hormone replacement therapy, does that help?
Yeah, that should help. There's other drugs that can help too. The lack of regular exercise is the biggest one. Okay, not the menopause. The lack of regular exercise is probably the number one cause, I would say. And excessive protein intake, because all those proteins are dirty fuel. The other fuels, carb and fat, it's all CHO. And so the byproduct is just water and CO2. But with protein, those nitrogenous groups, the amine groups, the body has to buffer them. And a lot of times they kind of leach calcium from the bone to do that, because there are a lot of phosphate buffers that can buffer the nitrogenous waste and get it out of the body. So excessive protein intake can leach calcium from the skeleton. So there's an animation of what loss of BMD could look like. Here's another animation of a vertebral wedge fracture. You see on the left, normal, mild, severe. You see a real x-ray on the right, the arrow is pointing how it wedges in. They call it a compression fracture. I call it a wedge fracture, same thing. That's kind of what it looks like for a fracture in the spine with loss of trabecular bone loss. I mentioned a hip fracture of the femoral neck. That's shown here. So I'll just kind of let you look at the micrograph and the illustration. They put numbers to it. I mean, they have a lot of data on this. But you can tell by there's less imaging here of trabecular bone loss. So there's more bone loss here than here. This is probably normal. The illustration shows you this is typically a hip fracture. It's kind of a misnomer, because that's the hip bone. We call it a hip fracture, but that's the femur bone, the thigh bone. Okay. So if it's really bad, you have to have a whole hip replacement, or you can just use screws to kind of keep it in there. But it's serious. So there's some categories of bone loss here. The category of low BMD means you're about 1 standard deviation, like below the mean for young people. At least 1 SD, I don't know if you took stats yet. A standard deviation is a variance. So you're at least 1 standard deviation below the mean of a bone mineral density number 4. Young females, age cohort 20 to 29, that's the prime of your life, right? If you're in this age cohort, you better be tip-top shape, because like you're the standard. And anyways, that's the standard. And if you get whatever their average is, okay, whatever number they get, maybe it's 1.04. If you're less than, if you're 1 standard deviation below that, you're considered low BMD. You're considered osteoporotic. Osteoporosis would be like, more than, I'll just say greater than 2.5 SD below mean. Uh,
of that same group, young females. So basically, if you're at least 1, 2, 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, 2.4, consider low BMD, get to 2.5 or more, you consider osteoporotic, so maybe I should put equal sign, you know, greater than or equal to. Just to give you an idea from a clinical standpoint, you know, they quantitate these things. So the risk factors associated with fractures, let me read that again, the risk factor associated with fractures. So this is a list of things that puts you at risk to have a fracture, because the fracture is the thing. So that kind of leads to this excess mortality in the elderly, so that's what we're concerned with. And the number one thing I put there is either low BMD or osteoporotic bone, right? That's the number one thing. Or anything that increases your risk of falling. A lot of elderly people, they have neurologic deficits. Maybe they have an akinesia where they're not very stable in their gait, their walking. Maybe they have impaired vision. So they're gonna have impaired balance, reaction time, gait, and strength. And medication can induce sedation. So maybe you're drowsy and you're more likely to have a spill and fall down. It's a concern. So prevention, bone up on your diet. Vitamin D does help. Is calcium intake, and I do list some intakes here, mixed calcium per day. You might want to take a supplement if your diet can't get you that much calcium. Let's see here. But the regular exercise is the basic one, because when you're in shape, when you're fit, it counteracts the bone loss, but it also inverts falls because your neuromuscular is better too. And when you do fall, it reduces the impact because you can brace yourself better, okay, because you're stronger. And the muscles, usually muscles surround the bone to protect them, so if your muscles are better developed, you're less likely to break bones. Everything's stronger when you're in shape. And so here's the loss of BMD with age, and they have a few age cohorts there. They have just black and white, male and female. Well, basically, this is the everything's downhill over 38, the figure, right? When you turn 30, it's like you cannot make this go up. It's impossible. You just lose bone mass as you get older. Even if you're an elite athlete, training all the time, maybe the slope is less, it's more flat, less steep, but you're gonna lose bone as you get older there. And so that's why it's very important. My professor used to say, put money in the bank when you're young, because at age 30, it's all downhill. Now, this is just kind of made up data. It's true though. It's all downhill after age 30 when it comes to BMD, and it's no joke. If your activity level is high, okay, you put money in the bank, put money in the bank, put money in the bank. And then, you know, usually at this age in society, you usually have gone through school and got your job. And a lot of times your job makes you have less time to do things like exercise. So your activity level goes down and the bone loss goes with it. Now, what you could do to prevent, if you exercise more, you increase the BMD. And whichever category of activity level you're at, if you're more physically active after the age of 30, you're just minimizing the bone loss. But again, you cannot make this continue to go up. It would just go down. Even if you're an elite athlete, your activity level, you start off much higher, but you still lose bone loss. And it's just like putting money in the bank. So when you retire, you have something to live off of. The more money you put in the bank when you're young, as you get older, you reduce your risk for the low BMD or osteoporosis category. It's never too late to start, even if you're a couch potato when you're a kid. You're never too young or old to improve bone health. At all ages, a diet with enough calcium, vitamin D, with the weight-bearing activity. What's weight-bearing? Jogging, swimming, anything. The best exercise, I tell students, is one that you'll do. That's really it. Now, the drugs that can help, alendronate sodium,
in a 3-year clinical study with postmenopausal women, they put one group on this drug, 10 mg once daily, to increase the spine strength. Well, anyways, let me show you the data. So I always choose data that's easy to understand, okay? Especially this hour of the day. Placebo, nothing. Flatline, right? Percent BMD, percent change from baseline. And you can see like almost a 10% change over 3 years. It's pretty good, okay? And so drugs can help. Let's see here. I just wanted to show you some of the data from that. So what you're seeing here is the placebo versus alendronate sodium. They show the fracture incidence. And if you're on the placebo, in every category, the fracture incidence is higher. I mean, that drug didn't make it all go to zero, right? But the idea of drugs, if you prescribe them to patients, is, well, will it help you? And these types of clinical trials are pushing to the next level so you can help people. So this is my last slide, is just kind of like going back. I don't know if you remember, I asked you this at the very beginning of the bone talk. So now that we know something about, say, this drug, at the cell level, basically, this drug localizes under the osteoclast. Osteoclasts are able to adhere normally to the bone, right? But they lack those ruffled edges at the border. Okay, that indicates active resorption. So when they lack that, they think that this drug is inhibiting that cell activity. The net result is bone formation exceeds bone resorption, leading to more bone mass. And many people slip and fall without serious problems. You know, why do you think this patient had problems? How would you treat such patients? Remember, I kind of asked you that question at the beginning of lectures. So I kind of wanted to put it at the end there. Yeah, go ahead.
It seems like doctors are more diagnosing osteopenia prior to osteoporosis.
Okay. Do you want to tell the class what osteopenia is?
I was going to ask you to elaborate on that a little bit more.
So what's your question?
The question is,
I have to look it up. Okay. Yeah, the process, I don't want to say this, I know for sure.
That's how they're interpreting the bone density scales that are coming out now?
Yeah, let me look it up during the break and I can comment later. Yeah, that's a good question though. Yeah, so there are definitely stages to how they determine these things. Like, for example, diabetes. You're full-blown diabetic if you're 125. Makes per deciliter fasting blood sugar. But what do you do if you're like 120? You know, they have these pre-diabetes. So there's all these like different categories of things. So let me look that up during the break. But before our actual break, I actually want to start this. I got to get the ball rolling. I don't want to fall too far behind. But I will look that up. All right, let's see. Next chapter. And I start this chapter like I started the last chapter, the case study. Okay, I always like to, when it's easy to do, I like you to see how what we learn actually applies to some of the pathologies that are out there that you might come across. This one's called The Tired Swimmer. It's a case study. Annie is on a college swimming scholarship. Recently, she had been feeling tired and her times have been getting slower. She has also noticed that her vision is often blurred. Concerned, she goes to see her doctor over the midterm break, and she's referred to a neurologist who finds that Annie is suffering from, well, it's more than just fatigue. This case study takes students through a series of stages that describe Annie's problems and symptoms. Students use their knowledge of nerve and muscle physiology to fit pieces together and determine what is wrong with Annie. So you already know what it has to do with, because I'm all muscle, right? Now this case is kind of personal because, well, many of you are college students. I think all of you are. I actually had a student who had this, and the first time I presented the case study, she came up and said, "Oh yeah, I have that." I'm like, "Oh, really?" So, I mean, it's out there. And but let's look at some other pictures. Like, when we talk about muscle, I mean, what do you think of? Here's like the elite end of it, right? An Olympic lifter. Now, to execute this lift, he's got to stand up, basically, which means he has to extend the knee, right? So that's all the quadricep. So think of all, well, you haven't had the anatomy yet. I think you know what the quads are, though. He's got to generate a contractile strength of, you know, over 1,000 pounds with all the force on the patellar ligament. That's the ligament that's going to connect the quad to the tibia, the leg bone, to stand up. So that's a lot of strength. From my perspective, this is what I think of when I think of muscle, a dissected cadaver, right? You remove the skin, you remove the subcutaneous, you remove the deep fascia, and you can see tissue in an embalmed cadaver. It has that brownish appearance usually. On a fresh dissection, it's a little more reddish because, you know, it's got blood in it. But the embalming process removes all those fluids. You can see it where it's like whitish. That's the deep fascia, which is a dense connective tissue covering the muscle. But you remove that, you can see, if you're up close, you can see the little muscle fibers covering muscle. That's kind of like the gross anatomy view of muscles. Well, anyways, here's a picture of the basic principles of a nerve stimulating a muscle fiber to contract. And this is kind of where I want to get into the characteristics of muscle tissue. So next chapter, muscle. So what we're going to learn is that muscle is an excitable tissue in which contractility is highly developed. Excitable tissue in which contractility is highly developed. I would say key words to highlight if you're a highlighter or an underliner: excitable and contractility. There's contract and expand. Which one means get shorter? Contract. So whenever you see that word, the muscle shortens. Okay? So basically, remember this. Muscles pull, they never push. And when they pull, they move a joint. And we'll get into that when we get into the anatomy, my regional approach to anatomy. Move a joint. That's why on the first day, I taught you those terms of movement, like flexion, extension, you know, abduction, that stuff. And we'll get to that. But for now, just they pull, they never push. That's a general rule. So. But what the muscle doing is they're transforming chemical energy into mechanical energy. Muscles transform chemical energy into mechanical energy. You know, you break those phosphate bonds of ATP, that energy is released from the ATP, right, into ADP plus inorganic phosphate. The mechanical energy is the pulling, the contraction, the muscle shortening.
What did you repeat what you said?
Oh, I'm just saying that the chemical energy is the ATP being burnt, and the mechanical energy is the muscle contracting. Mechanical. Okay. So what you see on that picture there are some of these characteristics there. On the picture, you see two cells. At the very top, you see the end of one cell. It's kind of the axon terminal of the motor neuron. And the rest of this big cylindrically shaped cell, that's one muscle fiber. Okay, so one cell is stimulating another. That's what we mean by excitable. So, this is like the following unit, nervous tissue. I haven't taught you that, but the main cell of nervous tissue are neurons. A motor neuron is one that will make your muscles contract, and you're just seeing the end of it, okay? So it's like, if I draw the cell body, like that, motor neuron. We'll learn this later. Just give you a complete picture. That would be like the whole cell, where it's like you have all these little processes here. This motor neuron can be stimulated by some cell. And it's like, you get all these areas of input. And maybe this thing fires an action potential. There's one special process called the axon, this one here. It's not a regular round cell. You have some of these processes which input information, maybe it stimulates this cell, the motor neuron, to fire. This will propagate down. To the axon terminal. Okay, let me write that on the board. Axon terminal is what I'm writing. It terminates on another cell, in this case, the muscle fiber. I'll draw another cell here. So you see what they're showing you? They're only showing you that's kind of what they're showing you in this picture. They're not showing you the whole motor neuron. They're just showing you the end that communicates with the muscle cell. We don't call them muscle cells. Typically, we call them muscle fibers because they're more fibery shape, not more round cell shape. You can call them muscle cells if you want. Sometimes people use the term myocytes. So that's what's meant by excitability. These muscle fibers, they respond to motor neurons. They're stimulated by nerves. Okay, so the next thing, contractility. When you stimulate the muscle, it pulls, it generates a tension. And it moves the joint. Let me give you a simple hinge joint illustration of that, of contractility. Say you have like an elbow hinge joint here, and you have a muscle that crosses the joint.
So maybe my belly, the belly of the muscle here, that's the muscle. The belly of the muscle is the muscle tissue. It itself doesn't attach to the skeleton. It uses connective tissue to do that. Like say at this end, and say at this end. So at the ends is not muscle tissue. It's connective tissue, right? It's tendon. So I'll just call it tendon. Since you know what that is, you looked at it under the microscope. It's a dense, regular connective tissue. So muscles use the connective tissue to pull on the skeleton. And so when it does, the muscle contracts. So it pulls in from there and there. And in this example, I'm only gonna move this bottom bone. It's gonna swing up. This top bone, vertical bone, will remain stationary in my example. So maybe it looks like this after it contracts. So I'm gonna kind of exaggerate here. See the length of the muscle? It got shorter. Well, that's contraction. And the joint moved, it flexed, okay? So that's what's meant by contractility. The term extensibility means you could contract over a range of resting lengths, okay? Meaning if you started, say, extended a little bit, the muscle's a little longer. See the belly of the muscle? It's longer there than when I started up there, but you can still contract, okay? You can contract at many different starting resting lengths, okay? I mean, extensibility. Writing, you can contract at different lengths. Muscle is extensible. It doesn't have to be at a particular length to work. Elasticity is the ability of muscle to rebound towards its original length after a contraction. So after you contract, it doesn't get all squished, okay? It goes back to normal. So after you contract, you can return to your original resting length, whatever that was, at this 90 degree angle. Okay, here's the belly. So we say that muscle is elastic because you kind of had it all stretched out, you contracted, you went back to the original length, and you're okay, you're still functional. Return to your resting length. You're still functional. That illustrates the concept of elasticity. So you're excitable, extensible, elasticity, muscles contract. That's a general idea. Now you have different kinds of muscle tissue. And they're illustrated here. We're going to spend most of the time talking about skeletal muscle. My last slides, I'll touch on smooth muscle. Cardiac muscle, I won't talk about it at all, because you'll learn about that in 431. You have a whole chapter on the heart. So focus on this, a little bit of that. But I think for all three, at least to categorize, you should know. So let's do that. What are the differences between the three muscles, even though we won't intently talk about all three, mostly skeletal? Muscle classification. In fact, the picture I just showed you pertains only to one of these, the top one.
the motor neuron stimulating the muscle fiber stopping. Right. That's one of them. Skeletal muscle. I'll just put skeletal, cardiac, and then smooth. One way you can classify these three muscle classes is, well, whether the muscle is willfully controlled. So we call that like voluntary versus involuntary muscle. It's one way you can categorize. Skeletal muscle is voluntary muscle, controlled by conscious thought. If you want to wiggle your toe, you can, by conscious thought. The other two are involuntary. Then you have the second category of how you can classify whether the muscle tissue appears striped or unstriped when viewed under a microscope. So we call that striped or smooth, striated or smooth. Striated means striped. Striated versus smooth, just appearance under the scope. The first two are striated. Smooth muscle is the smooth. Since that's a kind of microscope feature and have microscope pictures there, let's look at the skeletal muscle first and zoom in on it. Now, can you see how the muscle fibers are kind of parallel, horizontal in this picture? But do you see how the vertical stripes right there, each of these, there's vertical stripes? If it doesn't project that well, just look in your book. But those are the striations. Also notice that, you know, you have multinucleated cells here. So skeletal muscle is multinucleated, it's striated. The fibers are more or less parallel in the skeletal muscle. And also the cardiac muscle. Tell me if you can see the striations. Looks different. There's more branching because the signal has to spread the cardiac muscle to make the whole heart pump blood. Now, do you see these vertical dark bars? Those are the intercalated discs I talked about before. But do you see all the rest of the stripes going up and down this way? That's the striations for the cardiac muscle. Now the smooth muscle, the cellular structure is different. You don't have striations. They have contractile proteins, just like the other two. But there's just, what you're seeing there, it may be hard to see. Yeah, you have if I draw one smooth muscle cell, it's a spindle-shaped cell with one solitary nucleus right in the middle. And you're looking at many layers of smooth muscle cells. Whereas, you know, the skeletal muscle, it's like, it's a cylindrically shaped fiber like that. And maybe there's like a nucleus in it. Maybe there's a nucleus there, maybe there's a nucleus there. You're seeing all of these contractile proteins in it. It's hard to draw, but I'm not going to draw the whole thing. I just want to show you. Multinucleated, single nucleus. Okay. So just to contrast this one and that one. Now the last category of categorization, in addition to striped versus unstriped, striated versus smooth, is somatic or visceral. Whether muscle is located in the body wall or limbs, or makes up hollow organs and blood vessels, they call it somatic or visceral. Visceral means contents. Somatic means body, moves your body parts, that's how I think of it. Skeletal muscle is called somatic muscle. The other two are considered visceral. They either line your organs or line the inside of your blood vessels, or in case of cardiac muscle, it's actually the organ of the heart, it's muscle. So just call the other two visceral. So those are all the differences for the three muscle types. So if you see those terms, you know what they mean. I'm going to talk about the organization of the skeletal muscle. We'll do that when we come back from break. Take a break right now. I'll see you in 15 minutes.